Recently, we made a review for the Steam Deck. Checking the basics like its interface, specifications, controller, and performance in PC games. And in that video, I said something important, that it's the most powerful emulation machine you can buy for the price.
But there are so many things it can emulate that I needed to make an additional video. And here it is. Let's look at everything you can emulate on the Steam Deck, from Game Boy to Xbox 360. Welcome back, I'm Claudio, and this is Zero to Tech. Well, let's start by understanding how great the Steam Deck is. For the price, its emulation capability is far from any other device. The only one that might be comparable will be a used gamer PC, and I'm sure it won't be as portable as the Steam Deck.
Compared to Android, which is what we commonly see on the channel, being a PC, there are more emulators available. On Android, Wii and PlayStation 2 are the real limit right now. On PC, we can emulate OG Xbox, 360, Wii U, PlayStation 3, and even Switch with good emulators, not made from stolen code. To test, we're going to use this Steam Deck, which is not the same that we saw on the last video. This is the top version with 512GB. There are not many differences. Regarding the hardware, besides the storage, it's the same, except for the screen glass that has an anti-reflection coating, which can be seen here in how it reflects light. Good, but not a must-have. The included case is a bit different, with the top logo in color and made of a raised plastic. The zipper poles are white, as is the internal lining, and it includes a free bag for the charger, and a microfiber to clean the screen. For the price, the 64GB version upgraded to 1TB is a better deal. Now, installing emulators on the Steam Deck is a very easy process thanks to the community, which has created EmuDeck, a series of tools and scripts that makes the installation quick and easy. If you're going to use a microSD, which I highly recommend for the ROMs, the first thing you need is to insert and format it on the Steam Deck. Then go to desktop mode, simply by going to power and selecting switch to desktop. To make your life easier in the next part, you'll want to connect a mouse and keyboard to the Steam Deck. For this, you will need a hub or an OTG adapter. Once there, open Firefox. The first time, it will say that it's not installed, so it takes you to the application manager to do it. Once installed, open it and go to the EmuDeck page. Then go to downloads and select download app. When it's done, move the downloaded file to the desktop. To run it, double click on it, accept the security message, and we'll begin the installation of all the emulators. The process is easy. First select easy mode. Then, when it asks you where you're going to have your files, select whether it's on the microSD or the internal drive. When finished, you can close the last screen, and don't worry, you can always run the script again. The selection between microSD or the disk is simply for the creation of the emulation directory, with the ROMs and the BIOS folders. For games, it creates a folder for each console. You must copy the files there through a USB connected to a hub, or through Samba if you have a share on your local network. If you use a USB, remember to format it in exFAT, because the Steam Deck won't read it if it's in NTFS. Remember to also copy the BIOS files to the corresponding folder. The installation adds the Steam ROM Manager, which is a tool that finds all the games and adds them to the Steam interface along with the native games. Just be careful if your collection is huge. It also has the emulator's settings, which adds each emulator to the interface as apps. This helps if you need to change the emulator settings without going to the desktop. So, remove the console that you don't want, click Preview, then you can see how the games will look in the list. When you're done, finish with Save App List. This will close the Steam client and add the games. Then, when you return to the game mode, you will see a cover for each game. And, like any other game, it's a matter of selecting it for the correct emulator to load it, unless said emulator needs additional configuration, which we will talk about in the following sections. Now, if you don't want to mix the ROMs with the native games, you also have the option to install Emulation Station and have a completely separated interface for those games. It also groups your ROMs by platform and ROMs them with the right emulator. If you have seen any emulation console, like RetroPie, it's basically the same interface with thousands of options to customize it. After starting it, you can use the scraper to download the images and media for all your games, Just be careful of the options you select, because it can fill your storage with things you don't need. EmuDeck sets many of the commands that you need in each emulator. You can check this page with a cheat sheet of the common ones. It also includes information about the types of files you need to play. The only emulator that it doesn't install is Xenia for the Xbox 360. Right now, the best way to run it is on Windows, so you'll have to infect the Steam Deck and do the normal install. We will see more details in its own section.
Now, let's review each emulator to give us an idea of the expected performance. And let's see the additional settings for each emulator, especially since EmuDeck does a lot to get you started.
The first emulator we're going to see is an old acquaintance of the channel, RetroArch. And depending on the console you want to play, it might be the one you use the most. You will be able to play the oldest ones here, including NES, Master System, Game Boy, TurboGrafx, Genesis / Mega Drive with its add-ons, Super Nintendo, N64, Saturn, Dreamcast, Nintendo DS, and many more. The performance on all these emulators is perfect, nothing to complain. And the Steam Deck controller is perfect too, except maybe for the N64 with its weird 6-button layout. But the sticks are top-notch, although the D-pad is not that great for fighting games. Being RetroArch, it gives you access to all the options and settings we have seen in the channel tutorials, which includes overlays and shaders to make the games look better. You also get all the features like fast forward, rewind, and run ahead to remove latency completely. EmuDeck also sets some hotkeys by default, L3 and R3 for the quick menu, select and start to close the game, select and A to pause emulation, select and R2 to fast forward, select and R1 for save state, and select and L1 to load it. And don't worry, everything runs perfect. Even the hardest N64 and Dreamcast games can be played at full speed. They can also be scaled to the screen size and beyond with an external monitor. Now for the rest of the consoles, let's start with Sony. EmuDeck uses DuckStation for the PlayStation 1, and it's one of the best options. It's one of the emulators that need a BIOS files. You'll just have to put them in the created folder. And as you expect, the games run perfect. You can scale them to 2x to make them look great on the Steam Deck. You can upscale them even more, but if you're not connected to an external monitor, there is no benefit. With this resolution, you can lock the Steam Deck at 9W and will run great. Something weird is that when we run the games from the emulation station, it uses Beetle PCSX instead of DuckStation, so all the settings are changed. You can adjust it, but if you want to make your life easier, just run the games from the Steam interface. For the PlayStation 2, PCSX2. Just like DuckStation, you need to boot the BIOS files for it to work, and it does pretty well. They have been improving the performance, even adding Vulkan support. You can scale the games to 2x, which is the closest to the screen resolution, and everything looks great. Most of the games run flawlessly, but we did see some slowdowns at the heaviest parts of God of War and Ratchet & Clank, barely noticeable, and it also has some quick commands configured. As an example, select and R4 for fast forward, select and R1 to save, select and L1 to load, and select and start to close PCSX2. Although the execution is not perfect, there is no doubt it can satisfy your needs for a portable PlayStation 2. For PSP, we have the well-known PPSSPP, which runs flawlessly. Here, just like the last consoles, it is best to upscale it to 3x to use most pixels. If you're using an additional display, you can upscale it even more with no issues. The default configuration uses R2 to save and the L2 to load, which I don't think are the best assignments. At least the screen ratio adapts very well to the screen. Now let's start with the good stuff. One of the heaviest emulators out there today, RPCS3 for the PlayStation 3. If you have ever used it, you know it requires an additional setup process. First, you need to add the firmware manually, which you can download directly from Sony's website. Then drag it directly to the application using desktop mode. Then there are two types of games. First, the ones you downloaded from PS Online. They come in two files, one.rap and one.pkg. You have to install them before, so the Steam ROM manager can detect them. Then, those that came on disks. You must put them uncompressed, respecting the folder hierarchy. Basically, a folder with the game name with its PS3 gaming directory inside. I recommend adding them with the Steam ROM manager because Emulation Station doesn't detect them automatically. Now, don't expect all the games to run smoothly. The PlayStation 3 was a monster and emulating it requires a lot of cores, and the Steam Deck has its limitations. The easiest games will have no problem, but heavier games will need additional settings. And even then, the emulation is not perfect. Also, the Steam Deck's heats up like I have never seen. But hey, that's to be expected from an emulator that needs a gaming PC to run. Hopefully, they can improve enough so we don't have to wait for the Steam Deck 2. Now, let's start to Nintendo where first, we will see Dolphin to emulate GameCube and Wii. It works great. Same as the PlayStation 2, GameCube games can be upscaled to 2x with no issues. Heavier games like Automodelista have very small performance drops, but more like the original console than the ones we see on phones. You can also activate the hack for widescreen, and most games will look perfect. Regarding the Wii, there are more things to mention. This console already have a native white mode, so you don't need screen hacks, but with normal settings, the execution has some slowdowns, and the solution is not very intuitive, because it is to limit the number of threads. For this, you must install a plugin called Power Tools. It adds some options in the settings menu. If we lower the number of threads from 8 to 3, it does limit the number of cores to use, but those used can increase their speed, which solves the issue. Now we can play Wii at full speed. Another issue is the controls. To emulate the Wiimote, the default settings map the pointer to the right stick, but EmuDeck install a controller setting that maps it to the touchpad, which is a bit more intuitive and useful for Mario Galaxy. Finally, it also includes the select and R1 and L2 hotkeys to save and load. Also, let's quickly mention PrimeHack, which is a specific version of Dolphin made to play the Metroid Prime series with regular controllers. It can run almost any version of Metroid Prime, although the most obvious one is Metroid Prime Trilogy for the Wii. Emulating 3DS with Citra is not much of a problem. You can't use the touchscreen, but there is another controller profile called EmuDeck Citra 3DS, added by EmuDeck. With this, you can use the right touchpad to control a mouse pointer to simulate the touches on the screen. This profile also adds some hotkeys. L4 to pull up the menu, R4 to switch the screens, L5 to change the layout, and one that I didn't like, R5 to close it. Games run fine out of the box, with 2x scaling. You can try more, but the results may vary. But they look perfect this way, better than the original console, with very little slowdowns. On the Steam Deck, we can emulate Wii U using Xemu, and this gives you access to Breath of the Wild with all its mods, which is by far the best option for the Steam Deck. This is one of the emulators without native support yet, so EmuDeck configures it with Proton to make it work. Then the process is the same as any Xemu install. You install the game and all its patches. If you run it immediately, it won't run at full speed. For this, we need some mods. This can be downloaded automatically by Xemu. With them, change the resolution so that it uses the closest to the Steam Deck screen, and we enable the FPS++ mod. This allows you to increase the number of frames to more than 30, but if you set it at 30 or 40, you will see how it runs much better. The controller profile allows you to switch between the tablet screen by pressing R5, and something else you need for some trials, the gyroscope. You can enable the Steam Decks with an additional app called Steam Deck Gyro DSU, which EmuDeck can install using Expert Mode. With this, you can enjoy Breath of the Wild in another bulkier portable console. To finish with Wii U, if you have your Xemu shaders cached, you can load them directly and thus save the time and processing of compiling them. The rest of the games also run perfectly. If you feel any slowdown, it's a matter of lowering the resolution to 720p instead of 1080p, and that's it. You can also emulate Switch with YUZU. Normally, it is not a console that I check on Android because of the two emulators available, one is using a stolen code and the other isn't ready yet, but on the PC, there are two good ones. The setup process is the same as any other computer. The performance will depend a lot on the game. Some run perfectly with normal settings, but others might need additional configuration, like lowering the resolution, or you can search for specific mods on the YUZU page. It usually requires more work, but most supported games are playable. and the performance improves the more you play, as YUZU creates a cache of compiled shaders. We also have some of the common hotkeys. Select and date pauses the emulation, select and R2 speeds up the execution, and select and start closes the emulator. Now to start with the Microsoft consoles, first the classic Xbox with its emulator Cemu, with an X. If you have ever used it, you know that it requires two BIOS files, which you should put on the BIOS folder, and the hard drive that goes on the storage folder, then inside the one called Cemu. In my case, it was not enough just to put the files there. I also have to do the manual configuration by opening Cemu in desktop mode, which we see shows an error. Then, after configuring where the files are and restarting it, it works perfect. Games have to be in a special format called XISO. The easiest way to generate them is to use a tool called Extract XISO GUI. Once you create the images with the application, you put them in the ROMs folder. In general, the results are not very good. It does not matter that you put the games with minimum resolution. Some games are not going to run well. So far, it is not an easy console to emulate. It only remains to be seen if there are additional optimizations the team can do to make it run better on the Steam Deck. In this specific case, the performance of the Aya Neo Next was much better. Finally, we have the Xbox 360 with Xenia. This emulator does not run on Linux, not even with Proton. So, you have to take advantage of the flexibility of the Steam Deck and install Windows. The installation process is beyond the scope of this video, but basically, install it on a microSD or a USB and you tell the Steam Deck to boot from it. To get the best performance, we're going to use the experimental version of Xenia, known as the Canary build, instead of the Master. This is because there was a major update recently that improves the performance on several games. The most important for this test, Red Dead Redemption. When we reviewed the Aya Neo Next, it ran between 15 and 20 frames per second. But with this new version, it can run at 30 frames, which is the game's original speed. We cannot say it runs perfect. It has some slowdowns, but it's enough to be playable. And the same with most games. If they are compatible with the emulator, they will run at a decent speed, with a few hiccups here and there. Easily, the best 360 emulation we have seen in a portable system. Let's hope it continues to improve.
Now to close some additional points. All these configurations for most of these emulators are not that simple. They require constantly switching to desktop mode, but that's the way these emulators are. If you're interested in a detailed tutorial for any of these, just leave a comment and I will make a video in the field.
At least, updating the emulators is not complicated. For the Linux ones, it's a matter of running the application manager and selecting update. This automatically takes you to the latest version. For the others, you can run the EmuDeck script again. You also must be careful with some of the features of the Steam Deck. While some emulators can be suspended in the middle of the game and returned to, there are others where the games will hang. Just check which ones so you won't lose your progress. Also, you can configure the controls to make use of the additional buttons of the Steam Deck. By being able to configure them with all kinds of macros, including keyboard combinations, they can make your life much easier in each emulator.
Of course, it's not the only console of its kind. The Aya Neo Next doesn't have RDNA graphics, but with double the cores and Sentry, it has better performance in some places where the Steam Deck gets stuck. How much? Click this video to find out. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And remember, retro games, modern technology, zero to tech.